shoulder. Oh, oh, yeah. You tell me it's love, you won't let them go. You play with my heart, it's growing cold. See, I'm just a shoulder.
Yeah, you got that yummy, yum, that yummy, yum, that yummy, yummy. Yeah, you got that yummy, yum, that yummy, yum, that yummy, yummy.
Say the word on my way.
Yeah, babe, yeah, babe, yeah, babe. Any night, any day.
Say the word on my way.
Yeah, babe, yeah, babe, yeah, babe. In the morning or late.
Say the word on my way.
Bonafide stallion. No step on, or you stay on the run. Ain't on the side, you're number one. Yeah, every time I come around, you get it done.
50-50, love the way you split it. 100 racks on me, spin it, babe. Light a match, get lit it, babe.
That jet set, watch the sunset, kinda. Yeah, yeah.
Rolling eyes back in my head, make my toes curl, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you got that yummy, yum. That yummy, yum. That yummy, yummy. Yeah, you got that yummy, yum, that yummy, yum, that yummy, yum.
Say the word on my way.
Yeah, babe, yeah, babe, yeah, babe. Any night, any day.
Say the word on my way.
Yeah, babe, yeah, babe, yeah, babe. In the morning or late.
Say the word on my way.
Standing up, keep me on the rise. Lost control of myself, I'm compromised. You're incriminating. No disguise, and you ain't never running low on supplies.
50-50, love the way you split it. 100 racks on me, spin it, babe. Light a match, get lit it, babe.
The jet set, watch the sunset, kinda. Yeah, yeah.
Rolling eyes back in my head, make my toes curl, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you got that yummy, yum. That yummy, yum. That yummy, yum.
Can you stay flexing on me?
Yeah, you got that yummy, yum. Hey. That yummy.
Good morning, everybody. If you can do me a favor and just give me a thumbs up if you can hear my audio, we might get things kicked off. Awesome. I've got a couple of thumbs up. Thumbs up back to you guys. Righto. Good morning, everybody, on this very fresh morning. It was a lovely balmy 0 degrees about 45 minutes ago, so I hope your heaters are cranked up. Welcome to Business Before Hours for June. Before we get kicked off, I'd just like to for us all to take a moment to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which we're all meeting from today, wherever that may be, and pay our respects to elders past, present, and emerging. I'd like to do a quick welcome around the room to the awesome ANCC staff. If you can, guys, if you can wave when I mention your name. We've got Ross with us. Thanks, Ross. And Rachel. And Rachel, your Zoom name is Carrick Gilbalance, so that's awesome. Not on the call this morning is Gabby Burke and Megan Cullen as well. Board members with us this morning, I believe we've got Alex Berry, we have Celeste Pierce and Steve Owens. Thank you for joining us, guys. Bron Tyrrell, I believe, is trying to log in as well. Special welcome this morning. I'm not sure if he's on the line at the moment, but we are expecting him, Justin Clancy, MP, as well. I'd like to also give a quick shout out to Councillor Alice Glacken, Albury City, Brad Ferris, Deputy CEO of Albury City, and Tracy Squire, Deputy CEO of Albury City, all of whom are supposed to be joining us this morning as well. More importantly, I'd also like to welcome the sponsors. So our 2020 sponsors obviously support us in some extremely important ways, no more important than what could be at the moment, given the economic circumstances that we're all in. We are so grateful for their support. So just to quickly run through them. At Platinum, we've got Albury City, we've got Qantas, and we've got HIB Insurance Brokers and Blacklocks Lavington, with a new sponsor to be announced next month, which we're very, very excited about. Media partner, we've got 2AY. Our gold sponsors are Harwood Andrews and IBT. Silver sponsors are Shoreway Employment and Training. Bronze sponsors, we've got PRD Real Estate Albury, Total HRM, Integrity, Peter Stewart, and RSM Australia. Now, I'd just like to give a quick shout out to new members. Anyone who has not attended a business before hours before, whether it be online via Zoom or face-to-face, like back in the old days, welcome. I believe we've got Bert Easto. Yes, I can see Bert Easto with us this morning as well. He's our newest member. So Bert, welcome. Bert is a chamber stalwart from years past, and we're really excited to have Bert as a new member with us again just recently. So guys, before we get any further, I'm going to stop sharing my screen so that we can tee up ready for our first presenter. This morning we have got with us Jonathon Davis from TAFE New South Wales, and Jonathon's going to speak to us this morning about some training opportunities at TAFE New South Wales, which you can take advantage of. So, Jonathon, if you wanted to take yourself off mute and feel free to share your screen and kick your presentation off whenever you're ready.
Thanks, Carrick. Can you all see that? Good. Excellent. Well, welcome everyone, and thanks for the opportunity to present to you all this morning on this rather cold morning. So what I thought it was useful, just to give you a bit of an update about the range of training opportunities available with TAFE New South Wales. And some of you may not be aware that we actually have two campuses in Albury, one in Poole Street, fairly close to the centre of Albury, and the other out at Thaguna. But I'll just give you a bit of an overview of what training is provided at both of those campuses. So obviously, TAFE New South Wales, our Albury campus, is located in one of Australia's fastest growing business and residential regions, and provides a wide range of pathways to university degrees and successful careers. And at our Albury campus, we have our own hospitality restaurant where I was going to invite, hopefully later on when things return to normal a bit, I thought we might be able to host a business breakfast for you and actually provide breakfast for you at one of these breakfast meetings in the future. So what training is available at our Albury campus? Well, it's fairly wide ranging, from hospitality, commercial cookery, kitchen operations, etc., a wide range of health programs, and we've recently added the Diploma of Nursing to that list. And we will be starting a new Diploma of Nursing course based at Albury this July. And we're working with all the health providers in the region to provide that specialist training. Also have health and beauty salons. So we're often looking for members of the public to come in and have their hair cut or have a range of beauty treatments. So you can book in at our hair and beauty salons at the Albury campus if anyone has any spare time during the day to let the students practice on you. Again, a wide range of IT qualifications. We've just started a brand new degree in creative practice, which runs out of our Albury and sort of Wagga campuses, a wide range of business qualifications, and trades as well, and our trades quals are quite extensive. So we've got building and construction, plumbing, bricklaying, electrotechnology, motor vehicle, etc. I don't think you're going to be able to hear this video because we did practice earlier, but this is one of our students who graduated last year. Her name is Renee Jones. Some of you may recognize Renee. Renee actually did her practical placement at La Maison on the Causeway. She completed her Certificate 3 in Commercial Cookery, and she won a prestigious scholarship and went to serve, work rather, in a Michelin-starred restaurant in Taiwan. And so afterwards, this presentation will be made available to you. You can hear Renee's story. It's just a short 2-minute video of her experience in Taiwan and working at La Maison in Albury. Our Thaguna campus is quite unique. It's actually an organic farm. It takes 5 to 10 years to actually get certification as an organic farm, because obviously we don't use any pesticides or any other chemicals on our land. We've also got a few small farm animals out there, as well as a working farm shop. So on Thursdays, we grow our own produce, as well as we work with a local abattoir who cull our animals. So you can actually buy fresh meat from our organic farm shop called Green Gages, and it's operating on Thursdays out at Thaguna. So again, we have a range of environmental studies here as well as civil construction. So that's the range of qualifications and training that we offer at Thaguna, from organic farming to sustainable practice, conservation, land management, civil construction, water industry operations, and so forth. So with TAFE New South Wales, you can study in a way in a wide range of ways. At the moment, we've managed to try and shift a lot of our delivery to online or as much as possible. But we are, probably one of the most common ways of learning now is sort of a blended delivery model, where some of the modules can be studied online, whilst the others, the more practical components, are studied face to face. And we also offer customized training solutions for businesses as well. This is another of our students, Fang, who came from Laos to our National Environment Centre to undertake training at our National Environment Centre. He was looking at organic farming, so he could take some of those skills and that training back to Laos and to run his own farm and business. And again, there is a video link to his story as well, but he started out at Thaguna. And he said, I get to go on field days and farm visits and have much better access to learning materials and equipment that can help to better my performance. Now, Fang got a scholarship through Destination Australia, which provided him with this opportunity to study at TAFE New South Wales. And there's a link to his story there. We offer a range of short courses in business, short courses including business, retail, hospitality, and so forth. And there's just a little short video there of the range of training that we offer. We've also begun a number of courses in response to the coronavirus pandemic. So working with the New South Wales government, we've been promoting about 21 short courses to try and help rebuild communities. And what's been very, very interesting, last week our enrolments reached over 100,000. So that's been quite a challenge to actually get those students enrolled and get them access to those materials and support them through their programs. Interestingly, we got some government data on Friday. 49,000 of those 100,000 enrolments are actually from regional New South Wales. And of those, 33,000 are studying with TAFE New South Wales for the first time, which is really encouraging. So the areas are sort of grouped under developing administrative courses or administrative skills. So business administration, customer service, enhancing digital impact courses like creating, maintaining simple websites, how to use social media, in terms of health and medical knowledge, introduction to infection prevention, how to manage risk, business presentations, Excel, etc. So there's a range of short courses there. Enrollments are still being taken. So if any of your employees are interested in doing some fee-free short courses, please direct them to our website. We're also working with the New South Wales government, rather, to promote a number of fee-free short courses to support bushfire-affected communities. And one of the jobs I've got with TAFE New South Wales is to coordinate that response across the whole of the state. So we're now offering bushfire courses in not only the south of New South Wales, but also in the west and the north. In terms of the locations we're offering those courses at, Bega, Cooma, Maruya, Batemans Bay, Mossvale, Nowra, Tumut and Ulladulla. And again, offering a range of short courses, including chainsaw operations, first aid, farm fencing, forklift, basic welding, and so forth, as well as accidental counselling. So there's a whole range of, again, short courses that are available through those bushfire affected areas. In terms of financial support, in addition to those fee-free courses that we're offering to support the bushfire communities and in response to the coronavirus, we also have a range of scholarships available. So if you've got any, if you know of anyone who's 35 years and over, who's unemployed or recently been made redundant, or the employer is closing down or undergoing significant structural adjustment, then they may be eligible for a mature age scholarship. And again, you can find out more about that on our website. The Destination Australia Scholarship, which Fang accessed, who was in the presentation earlier on, is designed to attract and support students studying cookery and wine, environment and agriculture, hospitality, IT and travel and tourism, who choose to study and live in regional communities. And finally, Vet Student Loans, again, to support students studying higher level quals, predominantly diplomas and above. So those are the range of scholarships and financial support that's available. So I will stop sharing. Do I need to stop sharing my screen now, Carrick?
Thank you, Jonathon. We do have a question here from Jen Weller, which was posed pretty early in your presentation. She's asked, what is creative practice? Now, Jen, you might need to unmute yourself to give a little bit more detail to the question, if that's possible.
Morning, all. Yeah, I just wondered what was included in creative practice. Is it arts and crafts type creative practice, or is it, designing websites, digital media? What's involved in that?
Probably the best thing is I'll divert you to the website with it. I'm trying to see if I can pull it up for you while we talk. Just bear with me.
It's not a biggie. I can go look. I just thought you might know.
Yeah, no, not without looking and pulling it off the top of my head, no, it's probably best to look at the website, but I can certainly find you the relevant information and ask Eric to pass that on to you. That's no problem at all.
Yeah, we can circulate that in the email after the event this morning for you, Jen.
That'd be great.
Jonathon, we've also got another question here from Daniel Brear. He's asked, hi, Jonathon, can the bushfire-related courses be delivered remotely, i.e. for those potential students in the Snowy Valleys area, Jingellic or Tumut?
Yes, some of them can be. It really depends on the nature of the course. So if it's something like farm fencing or forklift or chainsaw, because if the nature is a very, very practical skill, they can't be delivered remotely. But some of the other courses that we offer can be.
Great. And do you have any insight as to what the most popular courses are for the fee-free courses that you mentioned, Jonathon? What's being taken up the most?
Customer service has been really, really popular. A lot of business have been interested in creating and maintaining simple websites, how to use social media effectively. That's been really, really popular. Introduction to infection prevention, particularly in the current climate. those are probably the key ones.
Yeah. And with the fee-free courses in particular, is there a time frame on when they're going to be fee-free, or is that something that TAFE New South Wales are looking to roll out long-term?
I think they're looking to roll it out longer term, and I'll try and give you an update, on a fairly regular basis, because my suspicion is, all as we're trying to get the economy moving again and the Prime Minister's announcement about more funding for TAFE, I think you'll see more fee-free qualifications being offered, not only just short courses, but full quals as well.
Yeah, fantastic. Righto, well, that's all the questions that we've got for now. We will circulate your details, Jonathon, in the follow-up email to members after this morning too. So if you do have questions, please feel free to get in touch with Jonathon. There's some really great opportunities in there to upskill, whether it's yourself or your employees. So I would suggest and encourage everybody to just consider what's available through TAFE New South Wales, because obviously there's very flexible options that that can add a lot of value to the way that you conduct your business. So thank you very much, Jonathon. If you want to stop sharing your screen now, Jonathon, and if I can magically pull up my running sheet to see who we've got next. Thank you, Jonathon. So up next, we've got Travis Connell from RSM Albury. Travis, if you want to unmute yourself and get yourself ready to share your screen. Travis is going to talk to us this morning about the end of financial year tax planning and business guidance post-COVID-19. So all very, very relevant things. Travis, over to you.
To go through some year-end tax planning strategies, obviously trading through COVID pre and post.
And obviously, we can talk about the government stimulus package as well. So we'll look at the things to consider before June 30, things to consider during COVID and post-COVID, and what key announcements from the government around the recent economic stimulus package and what it means for you and your business. Right, things to consider. So if we will talk through the strategy, the instant asset write-off, also the announcement of the backing business investment, the cash boost that some of you may have already received, and obviously JobKeeper, which you will have heard a lot about. These strategies will go through small to medium businesses and what to consider for your year-end tax planning. So if we look at prepayments, so obviously small businesses are eligible for a deduction for a prepayment if it's less than 12 months. So things like rent.
Sorry to interrupt. I've just had a couple of people ask if you can make your presentation full screen because their screens.
Sorry, it is, but for some reason, one moment.
If it's not going to work, that's fine. Just in case we can get it a little bit bigger so people can read it.
Yeah. Let's just go on to another screen. Hang on one second. Yeah, for some reason it's gone to another screen, so.
That's all right. We'll include just for those who are struggling to see, we'll include a copy of the presentation in the email after the event this morning.
Yeah, sorry about that. If you want to review your capital expenditure and consider any items of plant and equipment that you may want to acquire before 30 June, that'll help minimise any potential taxation consequences you have. Review any of your employees' super contributions, so your 9.5 that you pay on your employees' wages, and consider paying them pre-June, 30 June, to obtain a tax deduction. For those people that do have some significant tax issues and want to contribute some concessional superannuation contributions, you can look to put up to $25,000 into super and obtain a full tax deduction. So that might be something you would like to consider. If you trade as a trust, you will need to do your income resolution and have it signed on or before the 30th of June. current debtors listing. So I'd suggest that you look for any potential bad debts at 30 June. And if you're not going to get them, write them off before 30 June because you do not want to be paying tax on them if you have not received them. Review your plant and equipment listing to ensure that there's no assets that require scrapping or writing off. And if you hold stock, ensure it's being valued at any correct method. And there's two methods, cost or market value. Bonuses, if you're going to pay any bonuses to staff, they are deductible before being paid, only on the basis if they're definitely committed to paying them. Review your creditors to ensure you've accounted for all relevant costs incurred by 30 June, and they include your creditors, your work cover, payroll tax, things that you would usually pay in July but are invoiced before 30 June, and have a look at your income received in advance if some people are paying income in advance. And you haven't actually incurred that cost, you can look to push that cost off to post 30 June. For people that trade via a company, any Division 7A loans to associates, you need to ensure that your minimum repayments are met. Any donations made, ensure they are deductible gift recipients to obtain a tax deduction, otherwise you will not be able to claim a tax deduction. And any startup costs, so people who have started a new business or another business in the 2020 year, for small businesses are 100% deductible in the year of payment. Instant asset write-off. So there's been a lot of media around this. So there has been an increase from 30,000 to 150,000 to 30 June 2020. So to obtain this deduction, you must be a business entity, have an aggregated turnover of less than 500 million. So it was previously 50 million. You get the immediate deduction for eligible assets. They need to cost less than $150,000 excluding GST. There is a car limit. So obviously motor vehicles have a car limit of 57,581 and that does apply. They this instant asset write-off applies to new and secondhand assets. It needs to be first used and installed ready for use between the 12th of March when it was announced and 30 June 2020. The threshold applies on a per asset basis. So this means that you can go and buy multiple assets that are less than 150,000. And this is very beneficial for businesses that expect to pay tax before 2020. Backing business investment. So this is the 50% accelerated depreciation investment that the government have put out. Again, eligibility is around must be a business entity. Aggregated turnover has to be less than 500 million. You get an immediate deduction of 50% of the cost of an eligible asset on installation. Then the residual of the amount is used on existing depreciation rules. You must acquire from the 12th of March and be ready and installed by the 30th of June 2020. So it's an 18-month investment. It only applies to new assets, which is different to the instant asset write-off. You can do it for new or old. This backing business investment only applies to new assets. There's no limit on that cost. However, the car cost limit still applies, which we spoke about before. Any prime producers out there? So if you have taxation issues coming up towards June 2020, you can have a look at farm management deposits. Obviously, your income averaging will be there. And the 100% deduction for fencing and fodder assets still applies. So things like hay sheds, silos, putting some new fencing around your farm, you'll get 100% deduction in the year of purchase. So that's probably the main items around tax planning. Obviously, as we're now in the current environment, COVID is a massive player. So this is now just going to go through what you can do in terms of a business around trading through pre and post COVID. And liaising with either RSM or your business advisor to work through this. So budgeting and cash flow modeling for the 2021 financial year is pretty important. What you need to look at is monitoring of your actuals to budget, see how you're trading, what you can do to project the next 12 months worth of trading. Consider rental agreements. So obviously, if you're renting a premises, what potential access do you have to any rental relief and working with your landlord on that? review your current financial arrangements. So go to your bank, see if you can defer any home loans or get a reduction on your interest rates. The banks are pretty open to assistance in the current environment. This one's pretty important. Review non-essential business expenditure. So in the past, people would have spent money as they needed it and probably spent some things that they didn't need to spend. In the current environment, I'd be stressing to review all your non-essential business expenditure to try and maintain a bit of a cash storage. Review your current service offering and opportunity to pivot or adapt in response to COVID. So there's been a few businesses out there. An example might be a gin distillery that have changed their service offering to hand sanitizer at the moment. So if you're in an industry that you might be able to pivot, and then I know we're starting to look to potentially come out of COVID, but there's some opportunities in the future to continue to run those bit service offerings parallel to your current service offering. Continue to review available state grants and relief and any government incentives that you weren't previously available for. So I know that both Victoria and New South Wales state grants were available and also payroll tax relief. So if you haven't accessed any of that, I would suggest that you do so. Also, any JobKeeper incentives that you may not have previously passed the decline, continue to work through that to see if you do meet the eligibility. Review outstanding debtors and consider more robust debtor management. So you might want to look at how you collect your debtors, your payment terms going forward, and review your internal processes to maximize your output of your business. So the boost in cash flow. So this was the government's announcement in regards to the POYG rebate that the government will supply to you back up to $100,000 back to businesses with a minimum of $20,000. This is a tax-free payment and is not subject to GST. So what how it applies is it applies for businesses that employ staff and turn over less than $50 million and had an ABN as of the 12th of March. The payment will be delivered by the ATO as a credit. It's available for both businesses that are monthly and quarterly PAYG withholders. It's a credit of 100% of the PAYG up to a maximum of $50,000 for the first payment, and the second payment will be exactly the same as the first payment. So you got an opportunity to get at least $20,000 up to a maximum of $100,000 if you employ staff. The key date. So obviously it will have happened if you have done your BAS for March quarter by the 28th of May that we were around here. You will get another amount in the June quarter up to $50,000. If you're monthly, you will get it on each monthly BAS all the way to June. The second payment will be 50% in June, the June BAS if you're quarterly, and the other 50% in the September BAS. If you're monthly, it will be 25% over the June, July, September, August and September. So theoretically, by the end of October, you should have received your entitlement to this cash flow boost rebate, which is tax-free. And an example would be if you're a small POYG remitter, you have a couple of staff. On the March quarter, you had a $10,000 withholding for POYG. You will already receive a credit for $10,000. In June, you had another $6,000. So you will have had $12,000 over two quarters. So because you've already received the 10, you'll get a top up of 12. You'll also receive then 50% of that $12,000, which will be $6,000 in July. And the balance of that second payment of the $6,000, you will receive in October. JobKeeper. So everyone will have heard a lot about JobKeeper. It's been all over the news. So obviously it's aimed at keeping employees connected to jobs. It's delivered as a wage subsidy. So it's taxable to the business, but it's not subject to GST. Eligible employees for businesses that have turnover of less than $1 billion have to have a decline in income of 30% relative to a comparable period in a prior year. There's two types of tests. There's a basic test, which just compares it from current month. So it might be April to April the previous year, and an alternate test that looks at, and there's probably nine alternate tests that might suit any type of business. It's eligible to, so eligible employers are those currently employed, including any employees that you've stood down, must have been employed as of the 1st of March, and have an Australian citizen or permanent residence. Employees that are aged 16 and 17 must be independent and not in full-time study. You will receive $1,500 per fortnight for full-time, part-time or long-time casual workers. To be a long-term casual worker, you have to have been employed 12 months as at the 1st of March 2020. It must be passed on in full to all employees, and you're only available for one eligible business participant. So a business participant might be a director of a company who doesn't take a wage. If that company is eligible for JobKeeper, you will receive one eligible business participant that will receive $1,500 per fortnight, and that money goes to the business. You have business monthly reporting obligations by the 14th of every month to obtain the reimbursement. So if you haven't already been eligible for JobKeeper, I would stress that you need to continue to review your trading to see if you do meet going forward now every fortnight that the JobKeeper is open for. And this slide here shows the fortnight. So if you haven't currently met it, we're currently at the 9th. So if you haven't met it before fortnight 5, you have a possibility to try and fit into the future fortnights. And then once you're in, you will be eligible for each fortnight going forward. That's it from me, Carrick, unless anyone has any questions. And I apologise that the technology didn't quite work for me today.
No, that's right, Travis. Thank you very much. Some great information in there. We did have one question from Jen Weller. If you want to unmute yourself, Jen, and ask a question to Travis.
Hi, I was just interested in the startup deductions. Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Yep. So they might be purchases. So if you've had a cost to start up your business, so you might have traded as a company, so therefore you might have had some outlays around that, some accounting fees to do that, any sort of compliance costs, they're all tax deductible within the year. Usually they were written off over 5 years. But if you're a small to medium business, they will be deductible over the 12 months in which you have bought them.
And as a sole trader,
mm-hmm.
JobKeeper is extremely complicated because yes. Part of my work also is done through a university. So is there a cutoff date when you can apply for JobKeeper?
No. So what happened was, to be eligible for April and May, you needed to apply and enroll by the 31st of May. Going forward, it's done on a fortnight basis. So you need to be looking at your turnover per fortnight. And once you're in on that fortnight, you'll be right until the last fortnight payment.
Thanks.
Right. Thank you, Jenny. If there's any other questions, pop them into the chat feature, but it looks like there's none at the moment. Travis, thank you very much. I guess from our perspective, we've definitely been seeing that there's a lot of businesses that maybe similar to Jen are a little bit confused and about the JobKeeper payment subsidy. And our advice would be exactly what Travis said, really keep exploring it, keep a finger on the pulse, get some guidance and get some good support around you. This isn't particularly a plug for RSM, but I know, you know, if we didn't have that kind of the support and the advice from our networks, then, you know, who knows what would have happened. So keep pushing on with it. If you don't understand it, ask questions. Ask us and we can put you in touch with some people that might be able to help you, or go straight to RSM if you like. But definitely keep trying. Now we've got, Celeste has just said, call your accountant if they haven't already called you. So that's some great advice there, Celeste. If you've got a proactive accountant, they should be on the phone to you. Thank you, Alice, for your comment too. That was a great summary. All right, Travis, if you want to stop, oh, there you go, good timing, stop sharing your screen. Let's tee up our next presenter this morning. We've got Dan Brear from New South Wales Farmers, and Dan's going to give us a really important update on regional agriculture at the moment. We're hearing a lot of mixed things, but I think among most of it is relative positivity So Dan, if you wanted to unmute yourself and share your screen and start your presentation, it's over to you.
All right. Thanks, Carrick. And yeah, good morning, everyone. I'm just going to fly through and try and get this up so that you can have a lovely presenter view of what we're doing today. And I've gone topsy-turvy. So we'll try that. How are we looking there, Carrick? Is that...
Yep, that looks good.
Fantastic. Okay, well, yeah, good morning, everyone. My name's Dan. I'm the regional manager for the southwest of New South Wales for New South Wales Farmers. Been involved in Chamber for quite a few years and date back to the Albury Central days where I was involved there while I was working at the commercial club. So it's lovely to be in the room with you today, if not physically, the virtual, I guess, yeah, is still very exciting. So thanks for having me along. So New South Wales Farmers are agricultural advocates for our industry, making sure that we're looking after the needs of our state-based farmers. Our members range across a whole heap of commodities. We cover everything major right down through into small farms and boutique emerging commodities. So outside of the typical agricultural pursuits of grains, cropping, horticulture, we also support intensive agriculture through poultry, meat and eggs, and right into oysters and aquaculture and even cut flowers, which is all forms, different forms of farming, but they're very unique in their requirements and their needs to be represented at a state level. So New South Wales Farmers, as opposed to the National Farmers Federation, which quite often when someone's giving us a bit of a hard time, we get a lot of you National Farmers, but we are the state farming organisation and we are a member of the NFF, but not necessarily always in alignment with the NFF's thoughts. So it's a very complex space. Today, I wanted to have a bit of a yarn about what I was planning to talk about back in January when we first conceived these meetings and or conceived contributing to the chamber. And as Carrick said, the agricultural situation has changed drastically since then, but it's still very pertinent to talk about drought. And it's probably the most surprising conversation given what's happened in the start of this year, but drought's still very much on the agenda of our association. So just touching on the recent overview, and I was very lucky that while I was putting this presentation together, the DPI sent me some information through in their state seasonal outlook. So it's very clear that the drought isn't over. We have had possibly the best start to a season in over a decade. Farmers are very optimistic, but it is far from over. And one of the challenges that we are having is that there is a perception when dealing with drought that once it rains, it's going to be okay. But we need to get a crop, we need to get a harvest, and we need to get people back trading again before we can actually cause that drought to be over. So we are still in a financial drought for farmers because looking right through till August, pushing right through, we will need rain. We will need more rain to come through to give us a crop, potentially get those livestock prices back on, get everyone moving. But then you're talking about large scale areas of the state which have destocked and will need to reinvest in their business to bring it back and bring back that, I guess, business viability that they have struggled with over the last couple of years. So I'm not going to read the slides, they will be provided to you, but there's some really interesting figures on there. The next slide, and I'll just touch on this because there's a couple of slides here that I'm going to show you just to give you some context. And so this is a combined drought indicator. And as you can see, we had a lovely autumn, very, very wet and very widespread. there were patches of the state that didn't receive rain, but you can still see on this map, and again, have a look at it outside of this presentation and have a good look, you will see that some of the areas right up until today, the drought's actually intensifying again. And that's largely due to the fact that there is limited soil moisture. The classification around drought is not only based on rainfall, it's based on soil moisture, dam levels, and ongoing access to water and the conditions that surround it. So we're talking the mean temperatures, overnight temperatures, etc. So, as you can see, vast majority of the state is still in drought. There are pockets of it, and surprisingly through the western area, so north of Griffith and through there, I'd imagine that data there, and only interpreting, I'd imagine that next month when I look at this map, those areas won't be in that non-drought category anymore. So I think there's some anomalies in there with maybe some extra heavy rainfall, but that'll I can imagine those will disappear over the next month. So I thought I'd look at last year's chance of exceeding the median rainfall. And now these maps are very speculative. We know that the weather can get it wrong, but when you look at these maps, this is what the farmers were looking at after putting a crop down last year in April and May. They were looking at a pretty average situation, and that a lot of them were very aware of that. And when we talk positivity, we talk about this map here, and this is this year's June to August, excuse me, rainfall map. So it's something that is, I guess, quite complex in, we're looking at now a chance of achieving median rainfall. So looking at that 6 days ago prior, so the map prior to this one for June to August had most of New South Wales in light greens up into light blues. So 60 to 70% chance of achieving median rainfall. So that's where we talk positivity of the chances of us getting crops going, having a harvest this year, and obviously hugely positive. In 6 days, that changed quite a bit, but it is still very, very positive. I think if you can ask a farmer the likelihood of getting median rainfall, there will be a heck of a lot of positivity around. So it is looking favourable. It leads me to my final point, and that's while I've sort of got my details up there, if you do want to have a bit of a yarn to me, the final point is that our farmers spend their money largely locally. They support local businesses, and they obviously, through having communities such as Albury, we have opportunities to support our farmers. And that's all it is buying local. It's shopping locally, it's supporting those local businesses, but it's also making sure that when your farmers are coming in, when they're coming in, that they don't need to be told they're loved. We need to be thanking our customers for for supporting farmers. There's a very popular phrase around thank a farmer for your next meal. We're very much trying to change that to getting involved with thanking a customer for buying Australian. Thank you for shopping in New South Wales, and thank you for supporting the regional community. So I'd really like to see, I guess, the opportunity for our farmers to shop locally, try and get your message out there to those people that are coming into town. If they are, you know, if they're traveling in from Hay to Albury, Wagga, Griffith, wherever they're traveling to, they're usually coming in to spend up. And obviously we'd love to see them doing that rather than, you know, looking to that major spend that may happen offshore that perhaps they can be supporting the local businesses. So if there's anything that I can do in getting your message out to our farming community in the southwest of New South Wales, I do look after from the Murrumbidgee down to the Murray, from the top of the Great Divide all the way across to Balranald. So I cover a hell of a lot of area in there. I would encourage you to get in touch with me. A couple of points of contact for us. We've got our own magazine there. I've got some links. You'll be able to click on those afterwards. there is a new release. It's only coming out in the next week or so. It's called The Muster, and it is excerpts from our paid magazine, The Farmer, and it will give you an insight into agriculture and hopefully some great champion stories from our local members here as well. I do pitch stories of innovative and interesting people in our journey. So, you know, it'd be great to see some local champions. If you're doing something amazing to support agriculture, I'd love to know about it. Obviously, we'd love to see you interacting on our social media channels and getting involved in the debates when we do call out a politician to say, you know, we need support on these issues. We'd love to see your hat in the ring saying, yeah, support local New South Wales farmers, but support local communities. My name's Dan. I'm the regional manager, so feel free to reach out to me anytime you'd like, and I hope to see you face-to-face at a chamber event soon. Thanks, Carrick.
Thank you, Dan. And we'll circulate your presentation as well as your contact details in an email after this morning's event. There's no questions in the chat room for Dan at this stage, but Dan, I was wondering if you're able to tell us what kind of areas of farming are actually, you know, performing well and what aren't, like what kind of crops are performing well and what aren't. I think there's a lot of opportunity for businesses to support farmers, but if we know more about what's working well for them and where they may need some help, then that may help guide the local business communities supporting them.
Look, Carrick, it's probably over the last 2 years, it's been a bit of a quagmire, and I almost made a promise to myself that I wasn't going to say that water's the, bring the water debate and water issues into it. Our horticulture industries and anyone that's trying to create crops on general security water are very much probably at the forefront of the issues in the Southern Basin. So those farmers with horticultural holdings on general security water, but also looking at vegetable growers, our croppers have had years, 2 years where they've got a crop off. They've had fodder availability. They've been able to produce fodder, but that's the sort of, I guess, the failed crop tier where maybe that crop hasn't come through and they've cut it for fodder, which has been quite advantageous given to the drought in the north. We've been able to move quite a lot of fodder there. Transport's a huge one. If farmers are, using our transport networks in different ways, but there's always needs for, supporting that transport. So logistics, getting products to the farm, so the inputs to the farm or the output of the farm to the market or to the, end user. So logistics is a huge one. Obviously, getting that water, getting our water situation solved. And if I can come back to you in 12 months and say, we've solved that, let's move to the next challenge, I think I'll probably put my feet up and take it easy for a while. But I guess the general thing is that, our farmers, and I won't quote a figure directly, but for one of the comments that has come out in our lobbying to government is that when a farmer spends, they generally spend big, and that money transfers 3 to 4 times around the community before it actually leaves the community. So there's some really good evidence around it. I'd love to have it to hand, but there's typically farmers are big spenders. They do invest heavily in their communities. When you look outside this area, and I'll use Brocklesby as an example, that the footy club's propped up there by the farming community and farming related sponsors. So when you go out to some of those areas and see those footy teams and those social communities, they are backed by their farmers, they're backed by their local communities, and they're a real hub to hopefully keep young people in regional areas as well. We're seeing trends at the moment of farmers going, having their children off, they might go off to university, but they're starting to come back to regional areas. And that's quite exciting. Our young farmers branch up in Wagga is seeing a real level of growth where they move from coming into Wagga for university, but then they're going back to the farm with their either degree, or they may have gone away and got a trade, but they're coming back and applying that trade in a local community. And the primary producer metric is still there, but they've got an offsettable skill. So I guess, yeah, that trying to make sure we're keeping people in the regional communities is, you know, a fair aim for us, but getting people, young people, the next generation onto farms is equally as important. I think I can identify that my demographic is, you know, largely 50 plus. They're largely male, and they're largely, you know, hanging around making our policy. In the last 12 months, we've seen a real change in the people that are getting involved. Our young farmers branches are growing. Our female leaders within our association are growing very, very strongly. And we're starting to see a massive uptake of advocacy roles within our grassroots structure of progressive young males and females who are pushing the agenda of our association. So I find that hugely positive, given that when I started this, there was a pale stale and male tag on New South Wales farmers. And we're starting to see a real change in the diversity that we're experiencing within the association. So a few exciting things there. If you are passionate about ag, I'd suggest you, you know, come along, get involved. And, you know, it might be something that can give you an opportunity to connect and change the stigma of our association, which has been there, but is definitely changing. And I think the time for being involved is, yeah, right now.
Awesome. Thanks, Dan. Excuse me. Jen, I believe you've got a question. You just put your hand up. Oh, you're on mute, Jen.
I was just clapping. I was glad to hear that clapping. Dynamic is changing.
Thank you, Jen. Yeah, look, it's something that a couple of years ago, we had a guest presenter for our AGM, and he was talking about his business, which was connecting farm owners who are looking to transition into retirement to potential buyers within the country, and preferably younger buyers. And he was saying that was definitely a bit of a challenge moving forward. So it sounds like there's a bit of a pushback to getting on the land again, Dan. Is that right?
I think so. And it probably speaks to a couple of our last two presenters, in that, you know, you're going to need significant financial help if you're wanting to get onto a farm. The money is just obscene for the average person off out of town to say, oh yeah, I want to start farming, I want to get into agriculture, and I want that to be my primary source of income, is very close to unachievable in the real world. So opportunities, and I believe you might be talking about Sam Marwood there. Yeah. So, you know, Sam's got a model of trying to get people onto farms, which is absolutely fantastic. But it is one of those things that you are going to need significant financial advice, but you're also going to need training. And I think, you know, it's probably a fair wrap up for this presentation, that some of the work that we've done with TAFE and in getting training to farmers to do things to not only work, I guess, more effectively, but also to really rationalize the way that farmers are looking at their business day. You know, I still get upset when a farmer tells me that, you know, they're working 80, 90 hours a week and getting paid, you know, $12 an hour. You know, from my perspective as someone from town, would I get out of bed if work said, yeah, I'm going to give you $12 an hour, you're going to work yourself into the ground, and you're going to be, you know, have no time for anything else? I probably wouldn't do it. So trying to get farmers to realise that maybe they could apply technology to a role, or maybe they could employ someone to do something that will take that $12 that they're earning, turn it into something else, and they can be better served doing another task that will bring income to the business. So business planning, for those in the room that are business planning, if you have any ideas around that, I'd be more than happy to share, you know, your business knowledge with people to get them the ideas that putting a drone up to do the run around the fences, check the troughs, do all those sort of things, gets you out of the vehicle, gets you off the quad bike. It's a safety application, but it's also a practicality application that you could set that up. And while you've got that drone out doing that run of your troughs and checking whether, you know, there's lambing going on out in the back paddock, while you're inside doing the bass, or even better, while you're sitting on the porch, spending some quality time with the kids, is a sound business decision. It's, there's opportunities there to diversify the way that you do business. And it's not all, you know, belting out long hours and hard work. There is an opportunity for some very smart work in agriculture at the moment. And I think, you know, finding those ways to diversify is going to be the key to that.
Well, I think that's a conversation that we probably could take up offline, Dan. I think there'd be a lot of members of ours that are really keen to have a chat to farmers and you know, play a big role in passing on knowledge and educating and training as well. So outside that TAFE space as well. So thank you, Dan. If you want to stop sharing your screen, then I can jump in and share mine. Guys, that's it for our presenters today. I just wanted to say a heartfelt thank you to our three presenters today. Some really good information in there. I hope it's helped you guys in some way, shape or form. Just to finish up today, we have got a couple of events coming up. Events are still quite difficult for us at the moment. There's no face-to-face events, nor is there looking like being any for the foreseeable probably two to three months. So we will continue to have online events, and we are looking to build more of them over the next 2 to 3 months as well. So please keep an eye out on the website on our events page. Coming up, we've got on the 29th of June, we've got Project Management in Action, and they're going to be talking about portfolio and program management for small businesses. And then on the 14th of July, we've got Business Before Hours again. That's it from us today, guys. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. If you have any feedback for us, please feel free to pick up the phone, give us a call, send us an email. Until next time, we look forward to hopefully seeing you again face-to-face in the not-too-distant future. And all the best in business as we enter the recovery phase for the local economy here. There are some really encouraging signs, but we do have a long way to go. Please reach out, ask questions, and make sure that you're surrounding yourself with good support and good information like our three presenters have done for us today, because that will make our recovery a lot less arduous and hopefully more successful. So thank you, everybody, and we look forward to seeing you again next time, and have a good day.